standing by.
Good afternoon and welcome aboard this afternoon's sunset safari. We have a gloriously warm winter's day here on Juma, Arethusa and Cheetah Plains Game Reserves in the Sabi Sand in the Greater Kruger National Park area of South Africa. My name is Jamie and this afternoon I have the wonderful Brian Joubert on camera along with a very patriotically themed thumb, celebratory thumb, this afternoon, and we're heading out to see what we can find you on our live safari. Don't forget, not only are we live, but we are also interactive, which means that you can send through your questions on hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or you can email through to questions@wildearth.tv. This afternoon I shall be accompanied by the dulcet tones of the lovely Kirsten McLennan-Smith in final control, with accompanied by Chelsea. And we have the full team on board. James has headed out with Dave to see if he can't follow up on where I had Karula's tracks this morning. We'll be heading that way as well, but we thought we'd let James do a little circuit first. And we're heading off in a different direction, taking the opportunity to go and check some of the old hyena dens. Now, for those of you who were watching this morning's sunrise safari, you'll be aware that Brian and myself sat through, along with all of the viewers, probably one of the most, at the time, one of the most difficult sightings I've watched since I started at Wild Earth. And we came upon a very fresh little buffalo calf. It had just been born. It was still wet and desperately struggling for access to mom. Our mom, we later discovered, was lying up behind the group of buffalo that they were with. And she just didn't get up to feed her calf, and she just didn't get up, and we kept willing her up. Oh, hold on, we'll finish the story later. James is a rare little mongoose.
Good afternoon, everybody. This is a very special sighting here of a slender mongoose. It doesn't think that we've spotted it, and we seldom see them like this. My name is James, Dave's on camera. It's not that creature that you're looking at speaking to you. It is me from the front of the car. And we just so seldom see these things. That is so wonderful. They live on their own and sometimes in pairs. And that black tail, they stick up into the air when they're running. Because if there's a bird of prey that's about to nail them, well, of course, then they'll grab the tail and the mongoose will probably be able to move that out the way. Welcome to it. Welcome to the sunset safari, as they say. I am indeed searching this area for Karula. I'm not going to spend too long here, though, because I think she might need a bit of privacy after the amount of time she spent with us over the last little while. If we find her, that's great. Otherwise, we're going to head east to Cheetah Plains. It's been a hot day, 27 degrees Celsius, 8 degrees Fahrenheit, and there's some water there, and so maybe there'll be some elephants and buffalo and other animals around there. Okay, we are as live as Jamie, so please do talk to us, hashtag Safari Live, questions@wildearth.tv, if you are on the email. Lovely to have you along. I don't know how many of you watched our little school drive this morning at 11 o'clock. We didn't see a great deal, some elephants and some buffalo, and that tends to be what happens. During the middle of the day, we saw a couple of impala as well, but that is not surprising. It's a lovely, lovely afternoon. Oh, and we also saw a snake, yes. As Kirsten's just reminding me, we saw a snake on our afternoon, or our morning drive, our mid-morning drive for the Rodin School for Girls in Johannesburg. And we're just going to very gently drive along this road, and while we do that, let's go back to Jamie for her buffalo story.
Okie dokie, now that you've had your slender mongoose sighting, let us finish off with our incredible tale, and it really was truly incredible. By the end of the sunrise safari, I was really starting to doubt whether the mother was actually going to get up. I was worried about her having had complications after the birth or during the birth. However, we had to sort of leave it at that because it came to the end of the sunrise safari. Brian and myself went back there an hour and a half later to investigate and see what was happening. And I have to tell you that my heart was in my throat because as we drove in, there were just vultures and bataleers soaring around, which immediately made me think that something had gone terribly wrong and that the worst outcome had actually unfolded. Fortunately, there was no sign of the buffalo, either the mother or the calf or the other two that were accompanying her. And that can only mean that the mom got up and moved off and probably gave the baby some food before moving it, her, more safe, into a more safe area deeper into that block. So it really is a happy ending to that story, fingers crossed. I mean, hopefully from here on out, that little one will have a slightly easier passage than its first few hours of life, which consisted of mistaking a male buffalo for mom and wandering up to have a quick drink, which of course, the male buffalo being a male buffalo, didn't really appreciate the attentions of it and gave the little one a very solid headbutt through the air. It's amazing how tough these animals, how resilient they really are. When we think of ourselves and all of our medical marvels and the way in which, not that I'm saying we're not tough, but we're not nearly as tough as those creatures are without their antibiotics or their hospitals or their medicines. They just had to get up and get on with it. And she did so marvelously. It's amazing how involved one becomes emotionally. And I think both Brian and myself returned to camp this morning with rather heavy hearts, I suppose. We were a little bit miserable on our way home, so I'm happy that it's a happy ending. And no more sad sightings, Brian. This afternoon, no more sad sightings. No, let's find cubs playing in a tree or something similar. It was definitely a heart-rending scene. But all's well that ends well, and we're on our way to go and investigate the various hyena dens of the property before we go back and search about for Karula. I did try to find her this morning, so did Herbert. Both of us encountered the minor problem, not so minor problem, that the entire area was swarming with male buffalo. And as that little calf learnt itself this morning, it's not really an animal that you want to tangle with. My goodness. Sorry, distraction. That's quite a sizable elephant that's just walked along this, or has walked along this road this morning. I know you can't really get a sense of scale, so hold on one second. Hop out and have a look and see if these tracks are really as large as they look from where I was sitting. Yeah, a sizable elephant, but there were several walking along here, which I think is why it looks as large as it does. Brian, can we get this track here? It's one of the clearest ones that I can actually see the size of. Perfect, thank you. This is the front foot here. This is the outline of the front foot. Jeepers, that's big. This is the outline. Where's the outline? There it is. This is the outline of the back foot. It's quite an impressive foot size. I mean, I fit in that track easily. I could crouch down and fit in this track perfectly. That's incredible. It's an absolutely enormous elephant bull that's come walking through. He's got huge feet. I did actually hear something about that on the radio on the Game Drive channel. One of the landowners reported seeing an enormous elephant bull in must, wandering along Central Road. This has got to be him. You can see where he's been dragging his trunk as well. So that's got to be him. Apparently they had something of a standoff. Hold on a second. I have to figure out how to plug myself back in. All out of practice. There we go. All sorted. Right. Well, let's go keep an eye out for our elephant. Melissa, a very warm welcome to you. You were wondering how you can tell the difference between males and females within the track itself. The answer is you can't really. The only thing is the size. So there's no female elephant on this planet, I would be willing to bet, that has feet that large. It also depends on what you see around it. So if you see lots of little tracks, chances are lots of different size tracks, let's put it that way rather, chances are you are going to be looking at a female track just because it's accompanied by an entire herd. Whereas with the male elephants in particular, they're often on their own or with slightly smaller groups. In this case, he found a buddy. It's not just him walking along this road, but he did find a buddy. But either way, you don't really find elephant herds in pairs. Sometimes, but it's very, very unusual. The same goes for any of the animals. You're looking at the whole picture, not just one track. Although there are ways with leopards or lions, for example, you can tell the difference by size. There's a slight angular difference to the back of the pad, but that's getting a little bit technical. The easiest way is to look at the whole picture and see what that animal was doing, and then feed in what you know about the animal's behavior with what the tracks are telling you it's done. And then you've got a little bit of a better idea as to what the sex of the animal, often the age of the animal. I mean, this elephant that's walked along this road, apart from being absolutely enormous, I think it's pretty safe to say that he's well over 25 years old, just in terms of the size of the track. And I believe one of our lovely viewers, Penny Leg, sent me a sort of a formula that scientists use to calculate not the age of the elephant, but the size of the elephant by using the radius of the track, which is really amazing. It's incredible what you can do with mathematics. Our fox glove, we're actually going in the opposite direction. So when I stood in the elephant's track, he wanted to know which way it was going. I was standing in the direction it was facing when it made that footprint. So where I crouched down, I was facing the direction of movement. The backtrack always forms a little bit of a point to tell you which way the elephant's going to go. And very often, because elephants can be quite lazy, they very often drag the tip of their toes, so they flick a little bit of sand in the direction of their movement. So from where I drew the outline, the backtrack is pointing to where the elephant was going. So we're going in the opposite direction for now, but there's always the chance we'll encounter him a little bit later. And while we head off on our mission to find out about hyena dens, let's find out what James's plans are for the afternoon.
Now, everybody, most exciting, tracks of Karula going up and down on this road. Given my tracking skills, I can't tell which ones are fresher, or where she's gone, or why she's gone. But maybe just around here we are going to find the little cubbies. As I say that, and Dave thinks he's spotted some elephants as well. David, of course, not renowned for his extremely long sight. So it could be a fallen marula tree. So that is beastly rude of me, I know, I'm sorry. But let's go and look anyway. Now we drove up and down here for the school drive, and so the tracks are going up and down the road here. We'll just see if we aren't very lucky. So often I find that when we find these tracks and we think they're smoking fresh, we drive about the place and find nothing. David, where's these elephants? Oh, they've disappeared, have they?
No.
Interesting that.
Took too long to get them.
Oh, took too long to move to them. Oh, I see. Okay. Let's just drive very slowly along here, everybody. And let's help David spot. She's still going down here. Pallavi, nice question from you. You're wondering about Tingana and where he is. Pallavi, we had tracks of a big male leopard yesterday up in the northeast corner around Bivelshoek Dam. I'm pretty sure that's who that was, but I don't know for sure. And we haven't seen him for, I don't know, maybe 2 weeks now. So I'm not sure where he is. There are other male leopards, however, on Torchwood, which is to the east of us, and those other male leopards include a quarantine. He's killed something and he's lurking about there. And then we also have Mvula, believe it or not, he is also on Torchwood. Mvula, of course, is Quarantine's daddy. And they're not together, but they are both there. Right, let us drive up onto the bank here and survey the landscape, and perchance we will be lucky. I was thinking of speeding off to Cheetah Plains. I'm not going to do that immediately now, though, because those tracks look pretty good to my relatively unskilled eye. But the fact that we drove that way this afternoon, well, not just about this afternoon, sort of late this morning, indicates to me that perhaps we might be luckier than we normally are. Tracking-wise, I mean. But of course, she won't probably be moving around too much right now. The fact that she's going up and down suggests maybe she's killed something. She stashed the cubs not too far from here, and she's gone back to fetch them. I don't know. I don't know. I cannot predict Karula's movements. She's a wily one, that. I think we should go around that way, and then we'll come back here. Are you right with that day? No good. And some baboon tracks around here. And they're still trying to find a little bit of water in those holes that the elephants have dug there in Treehouse Dam. But activity around this area has generally decreased quite a lot since the drying out of those the pan. I mean, there were some elephant holes that were dug there, and that underground water was seeping up through them, and the monkeys were coming down, and the warthogs, and then the associated predators, of course. But since that's kind of dried up, there's been very little else going on there. And we found certainly that the southwestern sector of Juma has been pretty quiet, but for Karula and her youngsters. Now, I thought maybe she'd stash them over here sometime today, but I might be wrong. Certainly wouldn't be the first time, would it, David? No. I'm very sad that David didn't actually spot some elephants. I've spotted a buffalo's bottom, though. Fear not, everyone. We are now going to get a spectacular view of the rear end of a buffalo. In fact, even more than one buffalo. I hope everybody is as overwhelmed with excitement as Kirsten sounds on the radio. Now, I wonder if this isn't a little group. No, I think these are all bulls, so I don't think this is the group that Jamie had earlier today. There are also two zebra. I nearly said there's two zebra, which of course is not in fact English, despite its wide usage. The beefies now just getting mobile. They were sitting, sort of lying down, chewing the cud. I'm pretty sure it was these four of them earlier on when we did our little mid-morning drive. And they're now getting going and eating, unfortunately for them, the Strychnos madagascarensis. Let me just go a little bit forward. Maybe you see their zebra a bit better. Say when, David. Well, and every so often you are going to hear a thrashing, thumping, slapping noise. That's because I'm being attacked by flies. Beastly, beastly flies. Thank you. Lovely question coming through here from someone who has named himself Howard the Duck. Howard the Duck, you're interested in whether there are a lot of mosquitoes around here. There are not a lot of mosquitoes at this time of year. In summertime, yes, there are quite a few mosquitoes, depending on the rain. If we have a good rainfall year, then you'll find that there are plenty of mosquitoes about the place. But on a dry year, not so many. Well, in theory, I have to say that even until now, I've had mosquitoes in my room, despite my efforts to get rid of them. David, have you had the same problem? Plenty of mosquitoes have managed to survive through the winter, and I think that's quite an unusual situation. But yes, we do have mosquitoes, and Chelsea agrees, but Chelsea, of course, has taken up residence in Jean-Dre's room while he's away. And, well, you know, Jean-Dre's got all sorts of funny things going on in his room. That's very unfair of me, especially to cast aspersions on him when he's not here. But yes, there are mosquitoes around, and I don't know why they should be around now, especially as there's no standing water for them to breed in at all. These chaps picking up the last bits of grass that they can, and, I mean, they of course have the digestive systems that are able to cope with it, but many do not, and just lately I've started to notice that they're starting to look a little bit hippy, their hips starting to stick out a bit, but they're still in pretty good condition. And I think they'll probably get through the dry season. And interesting that they're with those zebra. And the zebra also, for various reasons, are able to survive in conditions that are perhaps poorer, or certainly better than other animals. And that's because they have this hindgut fermenting digestive system, which means that they don't have to chew the cud. And so if the quality of the food goes down, they just eat more. And that helps them through these dry, rough times. And both of them, of course, dependent on water. There is water around if you go and look for it. The Juma Pan, the Galago Pan, Biffleshook Dam, and certainly plenty around south of us and into Biffleshook. There are 5 or 6 dams there that have water. So the buffalo and the zebra should be okay as we go into a dry season. Now, the tracks of the leopard do not come out on this road, so we will go around to the parallel side of the drainage line once we've finished with our zebras. Pallavi, another nice question from you. You're wondering if these buffalo and these zebra are comfortable around each other while they are grazing. The answer is yes, Pallavi, they are. They provide each other with security. They do not see each other as a threat. You won't see them kind of in amongst each other very often. Sometimes you'll find a buffalo bull in a big herd of zebras just kind of imposing himself, if you like, seeking out the comfort of the extra eyes and noses and ears that will help him detect predators. But this kind of association here is not unusual at all, where you find them grazing in close proximity. They eat different lengths of grass, so there's not competition going on here. Right, that was a nice sighting, wasn't it, David? Very nice. It is quite hot out here, I must say. Alrighty, while we go around the next bend and parallel to the drainage, let's head across to Jamie and find out how she's doing.
Oh, we're just going to go around our next bend, which will take us out of the Mbubu Road hyena den, which was very sadly completely quiet and deserted. Well, I think that was to be expected, because either way it's a little bit early in the day to be checking hyena dens, especially on a day like today, which around 80 degrees Fahrenheit, it's a bit warm for our hyenas to be out and about. But I just wanted to get a little bit of an idea as to whether or not I think that Mvubu Road is still occupied. The jury's out, but it did feel very deserted. There was no fresh chew marks or marks where the cubs had nibbled around the plants. No fresh smelling hyena smell. I don't know how to describe it. It's kind of dog mixed with a little bit of fetid meat thrown into the mix. That's kind of what hyenas smell like. And I didn't really get much of a smell of that at all, that you usually associate with active hyena dens. And so we continue on our search. Hopefully, because those cubs are so young, the cubs of the new mother, hopefully they won't have moved too far away and we'll be able to find them. Maybe this afternoon, maybe tomorrow, Either way, I'm very keen on catching the moment in those cubs' lives where they're still tiny and brown and exceptionally uncoordinated. It's probably one of my favorite times to view hyena cubs. Well, the wind has been howling all day today, ever since we first found Karula's tracks when it started out. What that means is that a lot of the animals are a little bit nervous, as most of you know. Animals don't like wind. It makes them exceptionally uncomfortable. Elephants, anything from the largest elephant right down to the tiny mongoose, they all get a bit nervous. And I actually can't blame them too much in this kind of environment. I noticed it when I was trying to walk earlier. With the dry leaves blowing, it's almost, I wouldn't say deafening. Deafening is definitely the wrong word. But it's exceptionally disconcerting because it sounds like every time a tree rustles, like there's something right next to you or right behind you. And it must be very hard to distinguish between the dry leaves rustling and a predator creeping up on them. Oh, everybody hold on. Bit of a bumpy patch there. Ah well. The elephants I was trying to track have brought me right up to Biffle's hook cut line. They've moved on and off our shores, so to speak. Not quite physical shores, metaphorical shores. Because we've just hit the northern boundary of Juma. Which is the herd that we saw earlier on our special school drive in the middle of the day. But they've moved off. I know that there are some elephants at the pan. However, there are also guests that have just arrived. And I feel as though it might be somewhat of a disconcerting experience to just arrive at a place and all of a sudden there's a vehicle with a camera on the back. Not necessarily watching the guests, but they don't necessarily know that. And we won't go and bother them until they're out on game drive. Now while we look for any kind of heartbeat, they seem to be hiding away this afternoon. Aaron, in New Zealand, good afternoon to you. You wanted to know what species of Franklin is the least common on Juma, or the least seen. Obviously our crested and our Natal spurfowl, which I'm going to lump pretty much in the same group, we see on a daily basis, at least once a drive, if not more. We very often see them, but we move on past them. I think probably, Aaron, the least common would be the Shelley's Franklin, or the Shelley's spurfowl. They're basically the same family. And we hardly ever get to see the Shelley's, maybe once a week, maybe even less than that. Cokie are the next on the list. They're a little bit more common, but that's just also because they're so noisy. That koki, koki, koki call is unmistakable in terms of identifying them. So koki Franklin comes next, and then the Natal spurfowl and the crested Franklin are seen almost, definitely every day, almost every hour. Although now I'm looking for one for you, and of course I can't find one. They're all hiding away. And on dry days like we're experiencing at the moment, perhaps best idea is just to stick to the tried and tested tactic of checking all of the water holes as we go along. But before we do that, we're going to check one last den just to see if there's any sign of them at the Galago shortcut den. It's right next door to the Mbubu Road den. For hyenas, or for the hyenas that can go in a straight line, it's probably about 100 yards away. And Pulabi, you're wondering about, in terms of hyena dens and the fact that ours may well have moved, you were wondering if hyenas change their dens often. And it depends how you define often. The answer is no, generally not. They move every couple of weeks on average, but that time frame really does differ. Sometimes they stay at a den for only a few days. Other times they move and they stay for about 3 or 4 weeks at a time. That does depend on the den itself. It probably depends on how well ventilated the den is in terms of airflow to help reduce the buildup of the scent of the hyena cubs. Because obviously as babies they're going to defecate and urinate in the den site itself. Good news is there's hyena tracks making their way along this road. Those weren't very clear, so I haven't stopped for them. Now generally a hyena moves its den site because, most importantly, there's a parasite buildup. So anywhere where you get a collection of wild animals sticking around in one spot starts to become very smelly, the ticks and bacteria build up, and so the mothers move them off to a different area. And then the other reason is the fact that they, well, I wouldn't say that they do it to, maybe that's not a good reason, not necessarily but they do it to avoid predation, but the whole of the clan life centers around a den site. What I mean by that is, although it's the mothers predominantly of the cubs at the time that are always there, the rest of the clan will come by and visit all the time, as we often see with the clan males paying a quick hello to the females and their cubs. So what that means is that it's almost as though the core part of a hyena clan's territory has shifted to a den site. So by moving it around, they make sure that other hyena clans don't take advantage of a weakness in a territorial boundary and maintain their ties with all of the sort of outside or external areas. Sure, there's just elephant tracks absolutely everywhere. Hey, look, there's elephants. That was unintentional, but it worked out relatively well. What you're doing, you little thing? Why are you lying down? Are you rolling about? Oh no, not this angry lady again. I encountered her earlier today. Let's go forward a bit. She's fine. You see what I mean about the little... Wait, just before we go forward, just watch the ascent of this calf. He's been having a nap. Oof. Oh, but groggy. I'm just going to have a quick snack before I stand up. I've got this branch now. Oh, wait, I dropped it. Reach over. You're in my way. You're in my way. I'm trying to get up. Oh, there we go. Well done, baby. How was that nap? Little baby elephant. You going to come say hello? Yes, come say hello. Come say hello. You're very brave. Woken up from your wonderful nap by these horrible creatures and their big machine. Yes, little boy. Okay, now that he's up, let's shuffle forward a little bit, so that we've got a clearer view of the rest of the herd. The reason I said, oh no, not the angry lady again, is just because, oh, we're not in gear. That usually helps when you're trying to drive a car. But the reason I said that was because earlier today we encountered an elephant herd with a female who was a little bit unsettled, but I think we actually took her by surprise. We were straight downwind of her, so she couldn't have smelt us. And I rolled, so the engine didn't make a noise, and I think that actually startled her and made her a bit upset, like we'd tried to sneak up on her, which wasn't the case at all. Yeah, she's perfectly relaxed now. Oh! 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 Whoopsie. It's okay, Mom. Oh, you were just walking forward for a piece of grass. No, you weren't. Hi, girl. You still cross? We did announce our presence. Not my fault your baby was causing trouble. Here we go. It's a bit more relaxed. It's always important to be a bit more careful with elephants on windy days. They don't like it. Don't come cause trouble. Your mom's going to come cause trouble with me then. Yes, little one. I didn't start it, Mommy. Your baby did. The elephants are usually very good at knowing exactly who the troublemaker is. Seen it many, many times in practice. Okay. Are we calm now? Are we happy? Little monster. And while we watch our little one decide whether or not he wants to come scare us away again, Lavi, you're wondering about the dynamics of an elephant herd and who leads them, whether it's a male or a female. Well, the answer is an elephant herd is strictly matriarchal. So the herd is led usually by the oldest, certainly one of the oldest females. And when she dies, then her sister or her oldest daughter will take over and continue to lead the rest of the herd. Well, there's a sort of a misconception that she does it all on her own, and that's not entirely true. Because there's usually a... What are you doing? Fluffy creature. She's still all fluffy in this afternoon light. Yes, Mum's hastening its departure. Sorry, yes. So an elephant herd actually has a couple of older females that are responsible for the well-being and the safety of the group, as well as deciding where they go and what they do, keeping order, maintaining discipline, and most importantly, intervening when a male becomes a little bit out of hand. So the males leave the herd when they're around sort of puberty age, so sort of roughly 15, can be earlier, can be a little bit later. And I want to reposition just right now. Hold on for a moment, just see how this female responds, and then we'll move backwards a little bit. But the males will leave at a puberty. Once puberty hits, they head off on their own. But once they get to a little bit older, maybe around 17, 18, they are larger than the largest of the females. And what that means is that whilst an elephant herd is matriarchal, the males are more than capable of pushing the females around if they choose to. And it's only when the females band together that they're really capable of chasing an errant male away. But that's unusual. If it's a big male bull and must, they just have to keep moving away from him if he's irritating them. There's not much more they can do. So whilst it's matriarchal in the sense of their leadership and their herd structure, it's not a true matriarchal system in the same way that the spotted hyenas, where the males are larger, or the females are larger than the males, that is where the true matriarchal system lies. Very, very unusual in the mammal kingdom. Okay, now that they've relaxed a little bit, let's see if we can reposition, get ourselves a slightly different view. Hello, Trisha, in Toronto, and happy Canada Day. I think the thumb got all dressed up for everybody out in Canada, watching us in Canada. Trisha wants to know, it's a lovely question, whether or not elephants yawn, or whether any of the other animals do. Hello, baby, please don't get cross. No, don't, you silly Nunu. Because then Mom gets upset, and that's not what we want at all. Trisha, I've never seen an elephant yawn. That being said, I don't know whether or not they can, and I'm sure we've had this discussion before, but I can't remember what the outcome was. So if any of you out there, I don't think they can. I think that the nasal structure probably prevents it, the sort of the trunk adaptation being fused to the top jaw, I imagine makes it difficult. I've never seen. Have you ever seen an elephant yawn, Brian? I haven't. If any of you have ever seen an elephant yawn, I would love to hear from you. I don't think that they do, but it's entirely possible that I'm wrong about that. I've also never seen a rhino yawn. Hippo, of course, are famous for yawning, but almost invariably that's actually a threat display. But most of the other animals, Trisha can actually yawn. The lions do it all the time, leopards do it all the time. Usually as a prelude to getting up and moving off. So most of the other animals do. It's just the... I'm not really sure about the elephants. It's a really good point. They definitely sneeze. We've seen them sneeze before. And I remember we were asked... Was it elephants? I remember being asked about whether or not elephants can vomit. And we decided that it's very, very unusual. I think it was elephants, whether or not elephants ever vomit. I've never seen an elephant vomit. I think it must be a very complicated process. Anyway, sorry, we've gone down a bizarre route. It's sneezing. I've never seen an elephant hiccup either. But I've definitely seen a lion with hiccups before, and I've seen a leopard with hiccups before, so they definitely get it. But these herbivores, it's a little bit more tricky. Their gastric setup, their digestive system setup, is a bit more complex. They've got a lot of cellulose breaking down to do. Little one. The best thing about baby elephants, I think, for everybody, is watching them learn to use their trunks. It is such a complicated process. It's as complex for an elephant as us as toddlers learning to use our hands to grip and to grab and to learn those essential movements. And this one at this age, he's probably close to about 3, maybe just under, 2.5 maybe. And at this point he's mastered the basics. But there is a level of refinement that he's still a little way away from achieving. The more complex of movements. And that includes beating the grass that he's trying to eat. Oh, he's all cross because we woke him up. Sorry, buddy. Didn't mean to disturb your nap. And Kelly, you were wondering how old an elephant is when they stop lying down, when they take their naps. And the answer is, there is actually no age restriction, although you very seldom see the older cows doing it. You often see young bulls and older bulls doing it. They just can't lie down for as long a time period. So an elephant of any size, in theory, is capable of lying down. It's a bit more tricky getting back up, so they don't do it as often as the little ones do. And they'd rather find a nice comfortable termite mound to lean against, or a tree to lean against. Or, I'm done with this trunk grass eating business, I'm going to go for the easy meal. Let's see if Mom will oblige. So it's at any age that they'll lie down, but they don't do it nearly as often as the little ones do, because of course the little ones have got a lot of growing. They also don't need to feed as constantly as the adults do. I've seen a full-grown elephant bull lie flat on his side for a little while and then get right back up. We actually saw it this morning with an adult male elephant that was fast asleep on the ground. Mum's become much more content with the situation. Yes, you made your mum anxious, little one. I prefer the elephants that we see to not be anxious. Well, since we've been presented with this extraordinary view of our elephants, let's find out what James is up to.
James, I'm afraid, has been startlingly unsuccessful. We've done a few drives around this dam. I found tracks of the cubs and Karula, but I'm afraid I have been unable to find the Karula or her cubbies, so I'm going to just say that they don't really want to be found today, and because of that we're going to head off towards Cheetah Plains, a slightly circuitous route, but that's what we're going to do. We might be lucky over there. It has been a long while since I saw Inkanyeni, and I know Steph had tracks of her today, but I think they were going south across the Mala Mala boundary. Now many of you have heard us refer to Savage's track and Treehouse Dam, and if you look in this tree here you can see where the treehouse used to be, and it was called Savage's Track because they were going to have a TV show here called Savages, and I think it was sort of a C and D grade celebrities that came into this area, and they were basically had to survive. And there were cameras strapped to all the trees, and I think it got quite far along the road of becoming a real show, and then various things happened for it not to come to fruition. But they were going to live around this area of the dam and survive, and for safety they would go up into the treehouse there and hopefully not fall out of it during the night. It was like a sort of survivor on steroids, I guess, because I think there was actually real survival involved. I would love to have seen that show. I think it would have been most entertaining. But otherwise, like I say, things around here, very quiet. Yeah, HK, very nice question, and we don't really know. You say, do the Nkuhumas have cubs? Are they around, and how many cubs do they have? Well, we know that one of them has three cubs at least. She's still denning them on Torchwood. It's not long before she joins the rest of the pride. Where the others are at the moment, I'm not entirely sure. In fact, I'm not vaguely sure. We haven't had tracks of them on this reserve. There might be one in the drainage line system between Galago Pan and Mvubu Road, but it's almost impossible to get into that area in a vehicle, and we haven't been walking in there because the bushwalk pack hasn't been sending a signal out of there. So it's possible that she's in there, but we really don't know, and there haven't been many tracks going in and out of those areas at all. I'm just going to look at that very deep shaded tree quickly, just in case there happens to be a leopard hanging from its rather pleasantly shaded boughs. You see that tree there, David?
I do, James.
David will super zoom it for you so you can share in the experience of staring at a green tree swaying in the wind without a leopard in it. Very nice. Well done, David. On we go. Yeah, I'm of the opinion that she's in this yellishly thick block in here, which means that even if we were to find her, it would be extremely difficult to get a vehicle in without creating enormous consternation. So, treat your planes at ease. I feel a slight sense of disappointment, I have to tell you, but that's okay. Yeah, and Alice in Ohio, that was my other option for today, was to try and go to Arethusa and see if we couldn't pick up on Shadow and her little cub. No one's seen her as far as I know, Alice, not for a little while. And yeah, I think the guys at Arethusa at the moment, they keep seeing that leopard they've got called Salayeshe, and she's got two cubs. And so, I mean, if it's just easier to find her, then that's what they do. And Shadow has been on a place called Hoffman's, and Hoffman's, of course, is to the south of us, and I don't think anybody goes there unless it's actually a sighting. And that's where we saw Sandile disappear the other day. Haven't seen him since then, and certainly Shadow and her cub we haven't heard from or seen for some time. In fact, the last time we saw her, and I think anyone saw her, was when Roy had her going across here and then north up towards Simbambili when I was trying to find her very unsuccessfully the other day. So no, nobody knows really where she is. She could still be around Simbambili. She seems to have moved her cub further than Karula's been moving these little ones. And of course she's now 9 years old, and she has thus far failed to raise a little baby beyond the age of Sandile, who is now almost 2 years old. But Sandile had to have a bit of help, of course, from us, but that's okay. It was our fault he got sick in the first place. And for those of you who are wondering, Sandile is a 20-month-old. Can't stop saying 20-month-year-old. 20-month-old leopard who had to go into rehab because he caught a rabid dog. But he's fine now and he's back, and he's Shadow's oldest surviving offspring. She's had 9 litters, as far as I'm aware, up to now. None of them have survived bar Sandile. So we hope that the new one, who I have named Zara, let's hope that she survives. We might be lucky, we might find her crossing the road as we go across here. Yeah, I think in that very deep block, Karula and her babies, Maybe we'll come past you on the way back from Cheetah Plains, or Jamie will pop down here on her way. There's a single male impala, looking decidedly unstartled, almost like he has not seen a leopard. He's so startled, in fact, Wooly was startled by David. I think, David, did you startle him? I think it was me, in fact. I think I've blamed you enough today after your spectacular sighting of an elephant, aka fallen down marula tree. Well done. I just wanted to show you a quick tree, because I showed it to you this morning when I was on foot. And given the fact that there's nothing but one terrified impala knocking about this place, let's go and have a look here quickly. We'll keep our eyes open, of course, and our ears for growling leopards. Well, this is a gardenia tree. And the elephants have been knocking these over in many places. But this is exactly the kind of place, if you can imagine it. You still hear me, David? That if I was a leopard cub, I would like to be. So this is the kind of light and the kind of shade that if you're looking for a leopard, you have to look into. And if you can imagine how easy it is to go past a tree like this and see nothing, especially if what you're looking for is tiny and it's black and white and a little bit yellow, which is precisely the same colour as the light on this termite mound. Gardenia falkensii, the Transvaal gardenia, beautiful, beautiful flower when you get it. Ooh. There's a leg here. A nasty feeling there that I'd stepped into something. I will show it to you, everybody. Ah, no, it's not that fresh. In fact, it's quite old. I don't really feel like picking it up because it's got flesh on it still. That's really interesting, actually. So there was a leopard in this tree. In fact, I have seen a leopard in this tree. You know what? Karula was in this tree a little while back before we were viewing the cubs. But what's nice about this leg is that you can see all the different bones. So there is the hoof, of course, and that's the metacarpal. This is a front... it's a back foot. This is a back foot. So those would be the metacarpals. As far as I hear, I always get this wrong. Yes, that is correct. Is it? Don't know. Lots of different bones in the leg. I'm going to not waste your time and try and tell you what's going on. Oh, no, I figured it out. Okay, so that was the femur. That was the femur there. Okay, and that would have been the, that would have been the tibia. That would have been the heel joint there. So those would have been the metatarsals. So the reason I find this so interesting, everyone, is that in every single mammal, the legs or the bones of the bones of the mammal are exactly the same. And basically you can find parallels with every bone in our body inside something like this impala. And so that, for example, although it's quite high up on the animal's leg, is the heel. That's the heel bone that you would have found on your leg. I think that's quite interesting. I'm seriously tempted to keep this so that I might use it the next time we have the tent. David, I'm going to put it here. And you're going to look after it for me, aren't you? You don't lean up against here, do you?
Oh, I do indeed.
Do you do?
Yeah.
Okay, well, we'll put it on the bull bar. There we go. We'll strap it to the bull bar, and then I need to do a little bit of anatomical research so that I can understand exactly what is what about this bone. There we are. I say I don't want to touch it, and I'm wedging it in with my fingers. Should be okay there. Good. Pity she wasn't just freshly eating that now. Alas and alack. You see how I leapt into my tree. Right, let's go across to Jamie. She's at the Galago Shortcut Hyena Den. I don't know what's there.
Surprise, surprise, a leopard spot. Spots might make it difficult to spot, but a spotted hyena is never too hard to find if you know where to look. And we definitely kind of had an idea as to where to look. And lo and behold, we have the new mom. The hyena that I believe most of you have dubbed Gwen. With her torn up right ear. A hyena that will forever stick in my mind. I don't know, she's just for me one of the most easily recognizable hyenas. And Brian and myself had an experience with her many months ago. It probably must have been before she was pregnant, actually. Where she was being, I don't know what the word would be, disciplined, maybe, by the higher ranking females of this hyena clan. And she tried to seek refuge underneath our car from their nips and their bites. And she came out and she looked at us with such a soulful expression afterwards. It was terrible, with her ears all bloodied and torn and her bottom all torn up. And it was just forever imprinted her face in my mind. I find her incredibly easy, more so than most of our hyenas, I find her very easy to recognize. She's definitely up there as one of my favorites. So a sub sort of level hyena in terms of rank. She's not one of the higher ranking females in the way that Madam Corky and Pretty are. It was wonderful to see her here. She's obviously moved her little ones, the 100 or so yards from the Mvubu Road den, across to the Gallagher Shortcut den. That's become a little bit overgrown and actually quite tricky to move around in, not that it was ever all that easy to go about. But some of the trees are definitely at a different angle. That's made getting through a little bit more tricky, but for now this is absolutely perfect. We've got a clear view of her and the little cubs when they do decide to emerge. And it takes newborn cubs a few weeks, I would say, to get used to the idea and the presence of vehicles before they're brave enough to come wandering about and have a look at us with curiosity. Let's just chat a little bit about this den. The last time we saw them here was probably around the beginning of the year, December, end of the last year, beginning of this year, December, January. And we know that the tunnel that she is lying on top of connects across and through to the northern side of the den. So we're looking at her from the western side, across to the northern side, which is hidden behind that old dead leadwood and the buffalo thorn. There's a series of tunnels there as well, and it could well be that some of the other older hyena cubs are still hanging out around there. And Brian, good afternoon to you. You want to know whether or not hyenas excavate their own or create their own dens, or if they take over somebody else's. And, I thought her tail was a cub there for a moment. I definitely got ahead of myself, got very excited. But it's still a bit early for the cubs to come wandering out, and it is a little bit windy, which means that they might not poke their heads out this afternoon, but we'll keep our fingers crossed. I really want to see them. So Brian, generally what happens with hyenas is that they will find a termite mound. It's in this area in particular with spotted hyenas, it's almost invariably a termite mound, and it's usually one that has been excavated by an aardvark. So an aardvark started the digging business. And then quite possibly some warthogs might have moved in, maybe a porcupine opened it up, and then along come the hyenas and they take over. And den sites get regularly used and then abandoned and then used once again. The interesting thing about this, though, is that whilst they do take over existing den sites or burrows, the hyena cubs themselves instinctively create their own tunnels within the den system, so that they create something so small that they and only they would be able to seek refuge down there. So the adult hyenas never go fully into the den. We've seen them at the Mvubu Road den go right up so that their bodies are hidden, but they never go completely into the den itself, and that's because they can't. The tunnel's narrow, and the cubs have constructed their own little network where they can hide away and be safe. And that means that almost all threats are barred from entry. Lions, leopards, very few animals that would be capable of squeezing in there. Snakes, of course, are a different story. And hyena cubs are occasionally killed by them, as well as potential flooding. Although, it's just something we spoke about when it rained heavily, definitely not recently, about the fact that this Gallagher Shortcut den could potentially flood. You're looking very sleepy, girl. So some really fantastic information coming through from Chris Rogue, who has, along with several of our other viewers, put in a huge amount of work into keeping track of the different hyenas. Now, interestingly, from this information comes from Chris, and obviously from way before my time working here at Wild Earth, in fact, all of us, and that is the fact that Gwen, as she is known, the hyena that you're looking at, is about 3 years older than the matriarch of this hyena clan. So it just goes to show, unlike the elephants that we were talking about earlier, and thank you very much for that, Chris. I had no idea, and that is really appreciated. I remember saying at the time, when we saw her teeth, I remember saying at the time, she's quite an old hyena. Well, she looks quite old. She's been beaten up and scarred, and her teeth were yellow and cracked. But it's nice to know the exact age difference. And what it goes to show for those of you who are new to the system is how different a hyena clan is from an elephant herd. So we spoke earlier about the elephant herd and the oldest female, or the older females being in charge of the whole group. In hyenas, it's very different, and it's all about bloodlines, essentially. So they don't have to be related to each other. The females don't have to be related to each other. But obviously you get females and their daughters and their sisters that are related to each other, and then you'll get other females and their daughters and their sisters that are related to each other, and they have their own ranks. And hyena status, much like in terms of the sort of the old system of royalty, which is still not really applicable in the modern day world, but in the old system of having a king and a queen, the status is hereditary. So the cubs of hyenas inherit the status that their mother has, and vice versa. So her cubs, we've seen, she had twins last year when I first started working here, born in February. They're now almost fully grown, they're completely independent. They're still around and about though. Every now and again they come back to visit. So she had twins from last year, February. They would have inherited her low ranking status. When we compare it to a cub like November or Madam's January twins, Madam is the matriarch, or to the December twins, all of which will be higher ranking than Gwen's cubs. I know it gets a little bit confusing. I hope you all have a pen and paper and are charting this out accurately. I advise a flow diagram. Failing that, possibly chat to Chris Rogue and some of our other hyena experts that have kept track of our different clan members. Hey, that's really cool. So, wait, let's go through this again. There's another comment from Chris Rogue. Gwen comes from the sister of Madam's mother. Did I get that right? Yes. Yes, there we go. I did get that right. Sorry, Chris. It's a bit confusing. Which makes Gwen technically the aunt of Madam. Now I need a pen and a flowchart at this point. So that's interesting. It is a little interesting tidbit of information, and it goes to show that I haven't seen the dynamics. Presumably, that Madam's mother was higher ranking than, or was more dominant than Gwen's mother. But also, you know, we talk about the inherited status and so on, but I also think that characters come into play. We certainly don't know everything there is to know about hyenas. Researchers for the last who've studied hyenas all their lives don't know everything and admit to not knowing everything about hyenas. That's what I enjoy so much about them. So there must be a character level as well, because if Gwen's related to Madam, but she's not high ranking, at least she's definitely not right up there. You never know what kind of a role the character and the dominance of each individual animal plays. We're going to stick around for a little bit longer. In the meantime, back to Aaron's question about Franklins. James has got one of the rarer ones.
Everybody, there's a Franklin over there. Now, Aaron in New Zealand, I know you were asking about Franklins, and that there is one of the rare ones that we see. It's called a Koki Franklin. And it's the one with the golden head. It's not the rarest. The rarest is probably the Shelleys. I'm sure that's what Jamie told you. and it goes ka-tick, 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 ka-tick. That's the Shelleys. This one goes kooky, kooky, kooky. Or what do you think, Dave?
Not bad.
Not bad, thanks. Thanks very much. And I just think that that golden head, this is my favourite Franklin Aaron. Look at it. Looks like it's been dipped in molten gold. That's the male. The female, equally attractive, just slightly different. She's got more markings on her head. No, well, they're normally in pairs, so I'm sure she will be around here somewhere. And see how his head is almost exactly the same red-gold colour as the leaves on the ground there. They're the most cryptically coloured birds. And of course they're very poor nest builders, and they just sort of dig out a hollow a bit in them underneath the bush, and that's where they lay their eggs. And they're equally as cryptically coloured as the adult bird. I think that that bird is eating ants, if I was to guess. You can see very concentrated. I think he's probably found himself an ant's nest, and he's now eating ants. And ideally he'd be eating seeds, but of course this time of the year, seeds not really in a great profusion, unless you share cereals with me. Now, the other day, of course, I bought a whole lot of seeds, which I eat in the mornings, and David said, do you think I might come in with you on your seed eating? And so I said, of course, and I made the seeds and I cooked them up. And the next day, David was back on white bread and butter. And I said, David, what's the matter? He said, oh, it's so bland, so horrible. Well, the Cokie Franklin and I, we like our seeds. I'm not sure I'd eat the ants. And the reason they don't eat ants the whole time is because, of course, many of them are full of formic acid. And that's a defense against being eaten. And I think probably in the wintertime, a bird like this just has to kind of, as they say, suck it up. Just has to put up with the bad food. I think they'll also eat termites quite a lot. Just the most brilliant coloration I think imaginable. Look how his head perfectly matches those dead leaves. And you can hear the wind blowing. Still that strange northeasterly wind that we had this morning, and Viem tells me reliably that it's going to bring a front in sometime tomorrow that's coming in from the Indian Ocean, which is very odd for this area. It might actually bring rain. Hello, Aaron. You say that this is your 82nd bird for your list. Excellent. Well done. I'm glad we managed to do that for you, aren't you, David?
Yes.
Yes, it makes you feel good to add to a bird list. Franklin's extremely underrated birds. They really are very special. I can sit and watch a crested Franklin feeding, knocking about the place for days. Well, maybe not days, but certainly a little while. We're still on the Gowrie main road, so to the right, left of us, we often talk about Torchwood. That's Torchwood there. It's quite a large piece of land. That's where the Inkahuma lioness has her cubs. That's where Mvula is at the moment. That's where quarantine is at the moment. It's not where we are at the moment because we're not allowed to go there at the moment. To the south of us here, to the right, is Chitwa Chitwa. Very nice tourism lodge of this area. And I know a number of our viewers have been there. So if you would like to come out here, Chitwa Chitwa is an option, Cheetah Plains is an option, and Arethusa is an option. As are Vuyatela and Galago at Juma, but then you've got to book out the whole camp. They really are, I would say, pound for pound, if you're bringing a group of people to the Sabi Sand, the best value bed you can find. David, look at this bird flying next to us. This is unbelievable. Oh no, I knew he was going to do that as we got the camera on him. Righty, Jamie is back online. She's with the hyena, I think. Or she may have left it. Has she left the hyena? Anyway, regardless of what she's doing, let's go and find out from her. I'm going to do my little traditional donut.
We have left, indeed. We're going to go and follow up on that enormous herd of elephants that's at the Juma Dam. But never fear, we will be going back when it starts to get a little bit later and a little bit darker. And hopefully once the temperature starts to drop, the wind will follow suit, as it generally tends to do. The evenings around here are usually relatively still. And then we've got a far better chance of being able to see her brand new cubs. But for now, let's go and investigate and see what those elephants are up to around Juma Dam. Doesn't sound like there's any guests around, so we can go and sit outside and not run the risk of ruining their view. It's amazing, winter. I immediately feel the temperature drop. But I've also just got some amazing information from Wendy, where apparently, this is something I had not heard about at all. So apparently in the San Diego Zoo, they've got videos of elephants yawning, and they usually do it pre-dawn. And they're now investigating whether or not an elephant yawn is contagious in the same way a human yawn is contagious. Because of course, if Brian yawns now, which I'm presuming he's not going to do, for he is so enthralled, but if he were to yawn, I would obviously immediately follow suit. It's one of those funny little aspects of human behavior. Haha, Ellie's come. You need to yawn for us. Oh my goodness, parade. Hello. Before we go, just a quick view of these beautiful Inyala. Oh, they're always around the lodge. Okay, we can't delay. For apparently, although our elephant herd is on its way, there are more coming to join them, and I'd like to beat them there so that we are there for their approach to war. So I'm sure that they will. Oh, wow! Oh, wow! It really is a huge herd of elephants, and I'm going to show you in a moment. Let's go relatively quickly because they're thirsty, so we'll have a chance to get there as they make it to the pan. Hello, hello. Sorry, boy. Hello, Biffs. Oh, wow. Nice. Lovely big herd. Hello, boy. This is going to be beautiful. There must be, I would say, at least 30, close to 40 elephants coming in through here. They were a great deal more than that if you factor in the first herd that had moved in. Hello, guys. I'm thirsty. Maybe not so much. Or are they on their way to the nicer part of the water where the pipe comes out? Yes, this nice, fresh, clean water that hasn't been sullied by the other elephants. Oh, guys, you've arrived a little bit too late. The others have muddied the water completely for you. One intelligent elephant found out where the water comes from, and they're all... Ah, there's the one with the really straight, pointy tusk at the back. I know this herd, it's familiar, vaguely. I don't know it as well as I know some of the other elephant herds, but I've definitely seen these guys before. I think this might have been the elephant herd that you saw with James last night on the sunset safari. There she is with her straight, I don't know how one would describe that, almost sword-like, more spear-like, pointed tusk. Apparently James described it as a toothpick, which is not quite as awe-inspiring, I feel, as a spear, but we can go with that as well. Some of them stopping for a mud bath, having a marvelous time, not really wanting to drink the muddied water that's been stirred up by the elephants that came before them. One little chap's having an absolute ball. He's absolutely coated himself in muddy water. Obviously, he was feeling the heat a little bit. Whee! Must be quite an art to spraying oneself with muddied water with one's nose. This goes to show what incredible instruments the trunks really are. Is that better? Are you feeling a bit cooler? Wow. And this herd is very much on a mission. They barely stopped to drink. They're following straight in the path of the other elephants, watched cautiously by the buffalo, who of course will know about the elephant's tendency to get a bit protective over their waterhole. I think we should try and follow them and try and stay with them, just to see exactly what their plans are. Last little straggler's finished off with his mud bath. And as our little boy hurries to catch up with the rest of the herd, Mitch, on the subject of elephant behavior, oh my word, there's actually more coming. This is incredible. There's just elephants absolutely everywhere. Here they go. Although they're skipping the pan completely. Sorry, Mitch, I'll be with you in one moment. They've skipped the pan completely. They're on their way to the other side of the drainage line. Now, Mitch wanted to know whether or not the adult males, the big bulls, ever play a role in correcting the bad male behavior of the teenage bulls, so the young males. And the answer is yes, apparently they absolutely do. And their presence, you can see it even when you watch teenage boys around an older male, that they immediately have a calming influence on them. But it's not just that. There's actually studies that were shown that where young elephant bulls were introduced into the Pilansberg without any proper herd structure and with a little bit of post-traumatic stress, as well as no large males to control their behavior, they went on to actually kill several of the reserve's rhino, whether through aggression or through misplaced amorous intent. Nobody ever really truly knew. But as soon as the Pilansberg introduced some of the older 30-year-plus big male elephants, that behavior immediately came to a conclusion. They stopped killing off the rhino and the buffalo of that reserve. So a fascinating little story, and it's clear that an elephant male, despite the fact that we don't really see them as fathers per se, they actually play a very important role in elephant society as a whole, in terms of teaching them their behavior that they should exhibit. Okay, let's catch up with... Oh, they're going to catch up with the rest of that herd as well. I'm sort of hoping... The buffaloes just now managed to go and get a drink now that all of the elephants have left. I'm sort of hoping that our ellies are on their way to quarantine, because that would be extraordinary. Big open clearing, elephants everywhere. In the meantime, this buffalo is just grateful that they're gone, so that he's had an opportunity to have a drink. Now, he's not too fussed about the muddy water. In fact, his entire nose has disappeared into the water. Ashley... Excuse me. You were wondering about why it is that elephants don't like muddy water. They're fussy. That's the only thing I can tell you. I mean, they quite happily drink it if they're desperate. Let's go catch up with them while I answer. But elephants are fussy drinkers. They're known for it. If you watch them, whenever they're next to a river or a dam like this, if they know that they can, they'll dig a hole in the ground and bring up fresh water from the surface that's been filtered by the sand, rather than drinking from a muddy pan. Hello, boy. I know you. You've got the blind eye. Can I come past? It's okay. You're looking at me out of your good eye. I would like to come through, if that's all right. Shame. He always has to stop and look at you from his left eye. Because obviously his right eye is entirely blind. Okay, can I come past now? Thanks, boy. While we catch up with our fussy water-drinking elephants, let's find out what James is up to.
Oh, everybody, I have found two elephants that have found some fresh water here at three in a row pan. They seem to be very cross with each other. Seems to be a bit of a fight going on. Let's have a look. Two youngish bulls. It's very nice to see. And here's another one coming out of the bushes here with the rest of a herd. I think these are two young bulls who are probably trying to separate themselves. But just look at this kind of a very pale powder blue sky we've got. The grey elephants juxtaposed with the copper leaves that are falling out of the trees. It's a lovely, lovely sight. Here's a huge herd of elephants coming down to drink. You know what? Oh, it's big. Let me just move across the other side of the pan here. And let's get a view from there. I don't know how long they'll be here. We don't want to chase them off. They might not even drink. They might just be going past. This is wonderful. And you saw how those bulls moved out the way when that big matriarch came through. David, I might have to take some rank average photographs here. Yes. You just be quiet. You can have a post. You can have a poster, post photograph, say. Isn't that nice? Now let's time them, everybody. Time, see how long they take over here. They normally actually don't drink for that long. Unless they're sort of having a bit of a play. Beautiful, there's one tuskless cow there coming up. And I think, I mean, that's unusual. I feel like we've seen her before. Oh, David, that might actually be quite a nice picture. No, it's not. It's rubbish. So nice to see them drink. It's the most peaceful thing to do. Little ones and big ones. Wendy, a nice question, and I think the answer is no. You say, do elephants ever spray each other? Wendy, I don't think they do. I don't think I've ever seen elephants spraying each other at all, no. I think they almost always just spray themselves. This is a wonderful little scene we have going here. And I guess probably pretty similar to the one that you had earlier. Sharon, a nice one from you about whether or not elephants see well and how their night vision is. Sharon, they see probably at least as well as we do. So while that is, that's pretty good. Some people will tell you that they've got bad eyesight. I don't believe that. I think that they see pretty well. And something else I wanted to tell you. Oh, their night vision. Probably not great. I don't know for sure, but I would suspect it's probably not wonderful. Probably a little bit like ours again. But you know, they've got much better ears than us. Far, far better ears. And far, far better noses. And so although they don't possibly see that spectacularly during the night time, they are able to survive very comfortably at night because they're big. And they can smell and hear extremely well. Isn't that a nice little scene? Let's count them quickly. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. I've counted about 18, I think. And that's about a standard issue. It's a relatively large herd for this area, actually. Beautiful. Love these pale colours. Hello, Emma and Victoria. How lovely to hear from you. You are 5-year-old Canadian twins, and I believe today is Canada Day, if I'm not mistaken. So you're doubly welcome to our little show, and you say you're enjoying the safari and enjoying the elephants. Well, I think that's wonderful. I hope you continue to watch, and I hope you have a very, very happy Canada Day. Very nice to hear from you. Thank you. Now, these chaps have spent quite a long time here. They don't often, you know, like I say, the elephants do tend to move on quite quickly from their devouring or their drinking, unless they're playing, and these guys definitely aren't playing. Now, maybe this has got something to do with the fact that it's been a hot day, and we are in the middle of a drought, and this wind, combined with the heat, really has dried things out a bit. And I think you'll find that elephants, because they don't have what we call waterproof skin, like yours and mine, they also don't have sweat glands, you might find that a wind and heat would make them very thirsty indeed. They probably lose quite a lot of water through the skin on a hot, windy day like this. Now we have a question from a very emotionally charged Twitter handle, and it's a good one. Never forget Cecil. No, indeed, let's never forget Cecil. I'm assuming you mean the lion. That's not your question. Your question is, can an elephant get a cold? Are they? Do they ever get a stopped-up trunk? Never forget Cecil. I'm going to say yes, probably. Well, they don't get stopped up. I've definitely seen trunks where that are dripping with mucus, and I've definitely seen elephants sneeze, so they probably do get a sort of semi-cold. I don't think any animals out here get quite as sick as we do. I don't think they're prone to nearly as many viruses and things. Remember, they don't move, so they're born into an area, so they have a suite of resistance to the diseases and parasites of an area that many animals not born in the area would have. Now, were you to relocate these elephants, say, to the Luberon Valley in France, just by way of example, were you to do that, I think you'd find that they would start to get sick. In the same way that we as human beings, if you stay in one place and you don't have immigration from other places, you find that the people get pretty used to the diseases and they develop an immunity to them. And you know, the colonization of Africa, for example, is a wonderful example of this, where smallpox and influenza and all sorts of other diseases, which were eminently curable in Europe, wiped out massive numbers of people in Africa. And I think that's why you find people, because of our movements and the fact that we don't live the lives necessarily that we evolved to, we get a lot sicker than wild animals, which tend to live in the areas in which they have developed the resistance to the diseases and parasites. Also, of course, with the advent of medical science and the fact that we have live in an egalitarian society, semi-egalitarian, in other words, we live in a society where if you get sick, it's unlikely that you're going to, if you have a family, for example, it's unlikely you're just going to die and be unlooked after. Whereas out here, elephants, I suppose, will look after you for a time, but they can't afford to for the whole time. So if you do get sick as an elephant, well, the herd will stay with you for a while, but eventually it's going to have to move on or it's going to starve. And so you find that animals that are prone to disease get bred out of a population very quickly. Unlike human beings, for example, which are prone to disease, it doesn't really matter. It doesn't affect your ability to have children because we are an egalitarian society and we'll be looked after. That's very funny, that little one trying to drink. Of course, now the trunk is an utterly useless appendage until the animal is quite a lot older than that little elephant. And so if they want to drink, they've got to plunge their whole faces into the water. Right, well, from the water bath, let's go across to a dust bath with Jamie.
The most extraordinary sighting at this time of day, with dust flying everywhere, catching the light as beautifully as it does. There is nothing that can put one in a good mood in the same way that cute. Oh, you're being bullied, little one. Being surrounded by elephants. Oh, look, it wants to go and give attitude. But it's not quite brave enough, and it's definitely not really big enough. That's adorable. Fine. I'll just go off on my own then. Pushed unceremoniously out of the way. Oh, we've been sitting here. We arrived at just that little bit too late to get ourselves in the best possible position. But nevertheless, we've been treated to an extraordinary sighting. And there's something so prehistoric about watching an enormous herd of elephants walk towards you. I don't quite know how to describe what I mean by that, but there's just something so ancient and wise about them. It's the slow and deliberate way that they walk towards you. And there's easily 50 elephants at this point, probably even more. Oh, wait, Mum. Wait for me. They're all crossing, unfortunately not quite in the direction of quarantine, but it's nevertheless been a marvellous sighting. Hello, big girl. You're straggling. Here we go. We've got one very pregnant straggler. Hello, girl. Definitely bulging at the sides more than she might otherwise. And as she walks behind the rest of the herd, one of the largest and the oldest of the females, Shelley, you were wondering if there's an easy way to determine which female is the matriarch. You can't do it in one sighting, that I will say. It would take observation of the same elephant herd for a couple of days or a couple of weeks before you can get an idea as to which elephant is in charge. Shelley, she almost invariably leads the rest of her herd. Whenever she decides to move, she chooses the direction. But the reason I say that you can't actually do it in one sighting is because sometimes the matriarch actually decides to walk behind the herd and let her sisters or her aunts lead and go in front so that she can stay at the back. And it all depends on where the threat is. So it's not, I wouldn't describe it as easy, but it is very easy to see which of the females hold a high rank and play a vital role in the cohesiveness of an elephant herd as a whole. It's so wonderful watching their dynamics. Elephants are such extraordinary animals. And as the sun slowly starts to set and we watch them in this beautiful evening light, Jenny, you were wondering if they stop for the night and encircle the babies. And the answer is yes, if it's a very windy, very dark night, they may well do that. And they'll often stop to let the babies rest. But generally, elephants are not strictly diurnal. And on full moon nights or when there's lots of ambient light, they'll often wander about and feed and are relatively relaxed. The chances of a baby being picked off by a random predator are relatively slim. It would be a very brave elephant herd, or lion pride indeed, that would think about tackling an elephant calf. Munching away in the silver cluster leaf. But the squeals of the calves would immediately bring the rest of the herd running. Now, they don't really fear the night in the same way that the impala or the zebra or the wildebeest do. And they don't necessarily make their way out onto vast open clearings just to feel that little bit safer, in the same way that maybe the buffalo do, for example. But already the wind has actually dropped, which is an absolute pleasure. We're surrounded by the smell, the sort of grassy smell of elephants. Now, elephants are extraordinary not just because they're intelligent, but also their parts of their brains devoted to proprioception are incredibly well developed. In other words, they're aware of their bodies and the size of their bodies very, very distinctly. But Mitch, you were wondering, do they have sensory hairs on the on their legs to prevent them from kicking their young? And the answer is yes, they do actually have hair all over their bodies, from the tip of their trunk right back to their tail. Stiff, very bristly hairs, and those will play a certain role in sensing where they are in relation to something else, including their offspring. But for the most part, they've just got an incredible awareness of where everything is. They do have lots of blind spots, but they will, I don't know, it's an amazing thing that the young don't get stepped on more often. Was it yesterday, Brian, that elephant kicked the... Yeah. It was. So Brian was in the sighting with James yesterday with the same elephant herd, where an elephant cow just walked past and kicked the calf. Was it her calf?
No, it wasn't.
It wasn't her calf. She just walked past and casually kicked it. It was very, very clearly intentional. Elephants don't ever do something like that by mistake. They're just constantly aware, and I think that they build up an image not just through feel, in terms of the hairs on their legs. I think they actually build up an image of what's going on around them with their incredibly sensitive hearing. Almost like a kind of echolocation, if you will. They're just constantly aware of what's happening. And speaking of being constantly aware of what's happening, a very large tree has just been pushed over, I think. There was some serious cracking coming from the direction of the dam, unless it was some bricks being offloaded or something. I don't know what that sound was. Let's go forward a little bit so we've got another view of this calf. It's all right, girl. Okay, girl. Big girl, you're not too happy with that, hey? It's our pregnant lady who doesn't want, and she's just a little bit unsettled by the noise of the vehicle. And that sort of backwards glance out of the corner of her eye, as if to say, I'm watching you. If we have a look at the dents in her temporal region, she's not a young elephant. She's not ancient, but she's not all that young. But they can, of course, live up to 50 to 60 years old. You could just imagine the amount of wisdom that an animal of an elephant's intelligence accrues in that time frame. Amy, you were wondering, if an elephant lives up to 60 years old and their young don't have too many natural threats, that they're always protected by the herd, they don't have a very high mortality rate, what is it that controls elephant numbers? There's a couple of things. One is the a level of parental care extended to their offspring. So you've got that 22-month gestation period, and then another, at least another year, if not more, hello boy, of extended caring for their calves. So what that means is that a female during her lifetime probably doesn't have more than 5 or so babies. Whereas if you compare that to a lion that can have up to 6 per litter, it's unlikely to be that high, but up to 6 per litre, they've actually got a very, very slow growth rate, a very slow period at which they attain sexual maturity at around 13, 14, and it'll be a while before they have their first offspring. So that's one of the big ways that the population size is maintained. And then, of course, food. So every environment has a carrying capacity, a number of enormous pachyderms that it can support. And if it is not reaching those standards, the elephants either die of starvation, or before fences and humans, they would have just migrated on and dispersed elsewhere. Those are one of the two main things. Unfortunately, these days, well, those are the two natural... Oh, naughty boy. That female wasn't very impressed with you there. Shame, he's getting bullied from every angle, this poor little elephant. Unfortunately, these days, probably the predominant reason behind the control, if you want to put it that way, of elephant population is, of course, human beings. Oopsie. Ooh, making her very cross. Shame. He's just at that age. He's not quite ready to leave the herd yet. He's not quite big enough to leave the herd yet. But there's that awareness that he's not really all that wanted. And he's irritating these two females. There's one female that you can't really see that's behind a tree, and then there's the pregnant female that's off to the left. And I think half of her reason for her unsettled behavior is because she's irritated by him. Shame, boy. Not wanted by anybody at this stage. Must be a terribly confusing thing to grow up with a mother's love and affection and the tight bonds and babysitters everywhere you turn in your herd, in that herd structure that you've known your whole life, and then all of a sudden none of the females can stand to be around you, and you get pushed to the outskirts and you get barred from feeding on the tree you want to. Must be terribly confusing for a young elephant. I always feel for them at this age. The process of alienating a young male elephant from his herd is a long one, and I think it's often quite upsetting for the young males. And I've seen it a few times where they're clearly, it's not just me anthropomorphizing the situation, they are clearly showing signs of distress whilst being pushed away by the mothers or the other members of the herd. Shame, boy. You're going to come and take it out on me now. I'd prefer it if you didn't. Here we go. A bit more at peace. And as the last of our ellies wander off, we're going to make our way back across to the hyena den. Yes, cheeky. And while we do that, let's find out how James's exploration of Cheetah Plains is going.
Oh, we have just found two buffalo, everybody. They're just in front of us. A very strange arrangement. Looks like one cow and one calf. Now there's another herd of buffalo making its way towards these clearings. Why this lot have been separated from the others, I do not know. We'll just wait here and see, and we're also going to scan the clearings, of course, and see what's coming. Maybe the cheetah are lurking about here in the shade. Doesn't seem to be anyone else here, which is marvellous. Oh, one cow and one calf. How they've become separated is probably due to some kind of predator activity. And I know that there is a lion kill, I think on Chitwa Chitwa, where they killed a buffalo. Maybe this is remnants of the herd that was scattered to the wind by the marauding cats. See, they're looking at us deeply suspiciously. David, did I? I'm not looking at them, everyone. I'm scanning the clearings. Did I hear her making some dung? A plop.
Negative.
Negative. Something plopped. I wonder what it was. Anyway, there they go, running off through the clearings. So we'll take a little gentle turn towards the east. That's to the left-hand side of your screen. And let's see what we can find in the clearings here. We can find one crowned lapwing already. Oh, ostrich, running, high speed. Davy, far end of the clearing there. Charging across. That's a female in front. Is that the male behind? No, there's another one behind them, Davy. Yeah, that's the male, I think. Is it? Look to be both female. There was another one haring up behind them. Oh, there he is. He's in front there. In fact, there are three there. You know what? Those are two young males. I think those are two young males. Those are the three behind there. And I think they're young males. If you see the white underneath their wings, I don't think the females have that. No, they do. This is brilliant. They're all displaying at each other. Let's go a bit closer and we'll just keep an eye on what they're doing. But that's, I mean, that's a huge group of ostriches. That's a large wobble, as they say. Oh, I think they were running. I see another vehicle there. Perhaps they were running from them. Unless that vehicle is in some sort of predator sighting that I don't know about, which is entirely possible given the state of the radios. But that's a big group. Three of females are, and the male and his lot off in the clearings. Yeah, they're coming sort of back this way. I think this is absolutely brilliant. Yeah, let's go up here. We'll get a nice view of this huge long lens. Now, I've got to tell you, those things were probably, what, Dave, 200 meters, 250 meters from us when we used the super zoom lens. That's about, it's almost 1,000 feet. So the camera is fantastic. This is awesome. Hang on a sec. Let's head up that way. Just get an update from this vehicle that we're going past now and see if there isn't some kind of an interesting thing that they're able to tell us. Good afternoon. Some substantial birds running across the clearing. Yes, I did. Very exciting. Not small, those fellows. Yes. I think they're six.
Six?
Yeah. A large wobble of ostriches. I have no idea. I'll go and find out. I'll let you know. Yes. Have you seen anything of late?
Chilling.
Chilling. Okay. Okay. Cool. See you later. So that was Sean, everyone, from Arethusa. And he's just saying he's driving around here hoping, a bit like us, to see a male lion or perhaps a cheetah. Now, here are our ostriches scattered to the wind. Ah, now, James Richard, you want to know how the smells of the bush differ on cheetah plains compared with, say, Juma? Not one bit. They really don't smell, it doesn't smell at all different, James. And that's because, I mean, it's pretty much the same place. I know the clearings are different sort of vegetation, but I suppose there might be, if we're sitting in the clearings here, there might be slightly less of a smell of that drying leaf litter that we get in the woodlands. But it's no different really from the smell and that would get in a clearing on, say, Juma or Arethusa. This is fantastic. Why they were running around. So how many we got there? I think we've got six. Seven. Now, let's see if anyone agrees with me. I'm beginning to think that the three on the left hand, four on the left hand side, that's our normal wobble of male and three females. No, the others look to be all females. I thought for a second they might be young males, but I don't think they are. I think that male has just got his work cut out from him now. Look at them opening their wings. They are the most incongruous looking creatures. And if you see them displaying at each other, it's the most ridiculous thing in the world. They sort of twist their wings around in a like propellers. And clearly there's a level of distress here. Maybe his three wives think that he's about to take another three, which of course he will do, absolutely, if he can. Fantastic sighting. They are so funny. I don't know why they're so funny, but they are. I guess it's the absolute look of complete surprise they have on their faces most of the time. And if they relax, their tails are down. And you can see the tail of the one going up and down there. You see how their feathers are very different from a bird that flies feathers. They're not held together, but the barbs of each feather are not individually held together by the velcro-like barbicels and barbules. So the feathers are almost, they almost take on the appearance of hair, which they are not, of course, standard issue feathers, those. But they don't stick together because they don't fly, and so they don't have to have the same level of care administered to them, because, of course, they are not flying birds. Absolutely amazing. Oh yes, good idea, James Dungan. You want to see an ostrich track one day. They are fascinating tracks. It looks like two fairly large sausages side by side. They've only got two toes. Herd of buffalo now running towards us. Here they come. Davy, there they are. They're coming out of the bush now. Look at this. Look at the dust. I don't know why they're running. Maybe there's a lion in there. Paul, you're interested in whether ostriches are territorial or not. No, they're not. They are, I think, fairly nomadic. Look at the dust there. I don't know. Let's just keep an eye on there, everyone. And I mean, it's quite possible there's a lion in there. Something spooked them and they ran. And I know, you remember those three lionesses and the two males that were on that buffalo kill the other day. They don't know where those three lionesses went. That's fascinating. They're now looking at us. It's so great having this camera where we can see so much. From such a vast distance away, the ostriches continue to lurk in the clearing here. I don't think we should move. I think we should stay right here. In fact, I do think we should move. I think we should go a little bit closer to the buffalo. Oh no, hang on. Look at the ostriches. One of the big females is chasing these other ones away. Now, you do not want to get in the way of an angry ostrich. They can be utterly terrifying. As the golden light of the late afternoon descends on the magnificent plains of Cheetah. Oh, Gail, what a lovely question. You say, does anything just run ever for the sake of it, for the joy of running? Youngsters do, certainly. Young animals do in the much the same way that young children do. Sometimes you see a herd of animals just kind of running around the place. Buffalo, I've never seen them do that. I've certainly never seen a leopard or a lion running for fun. I'm going to say very few, Gail. I've certainly had that feeling, though, you know, when I go for a run fairly regularly, but sometimes it's a real sort of effort to make myself do it. And sometimes you just feel that amazing sense of joy and freedom, just when you're not stiff and sore and your mind is clear. And I wonder if animals do the same thing. I don't think many of them do, you know. I mean, imagine being a bird. Imagine how much you'd fly for fun. Unless you're an ostrich, of course, in which case you cannot fly. Can you, David? No, you cannot. Good. HK, an interesting one from you. What makes ostriches unable to fly? Well, from a purely practical point of view, their mass, they're very heavy, up to 100 kilos for a big male. Secondly, their wings are not designed for flight. You can see they're designed almost exclusively for warmth and for display. So their feathers are not flight feathers. So the flight feathers on a bird are long. Their wings are much longer than an ostrich's wings. And they are designed differently to, like an aerofoil. They don't allow air through them. Whereas it would be totally impossible for an ostrich to do that. Ooh, Sean has spotted a Temminck coursa, which is a very interesting bird that some of you will not have. Where is it, Sean? Can you see it? Sean, there it is. There it is running there, and you've seen one with Steph. There are two back there. Sorry, I don't want to reverse. You see them there, Dave? Sorry, but I don't want to reverse and chase them off. That's fantastic. Wow, that's great. Look at that. Beautiful birds. Oh, that's great. Well done, Sean. How cool is that, everyone? The Temminck coursa. Temminck, some naturalist after whom these birds were named. That is fantastic. And see our shadows there. The shadows are getting long as the day progresses. Now these buffalo have formed up in a phalanx in front of us. And it's a sort of defensive phalanx, if you like. I don't know what's caused their consternation or what's chased them out of the woodland there. Maybe a lion. They ain't coming any closer to us. That said, they don't seem to be particularly panicked anymore. And there were certainly no distress calls. It's all happening here on Cheetah Plains. Now, back to the question of why ostriches can't fly. Evolution-wise, they can't fly because they've lost the ability to fly because they've moved into a different niche. So I don't know too much about the history of their evolution, but they obviously occupy a niche that other animals don't occupy. They eat, they eat fresh sort of shoots. So they'll eat forbs and buds and possibly the odd bit of fruit that few birds are able to eat. And with their size, they haven't had to be able to. So they've, instead of having flight as a defensive mechanism, they've developed size. And so I think that's why they don't fly. Let's go back across to Jamie. She is back with the hyenas.
For the moment, just hyena singular, no plural about. It's just Gwen, still sitting at the entrance to the den. I must say, the Mvubu Road den definitely had an advantage over the Galago shortcut den in that it had a far more comfortable spot for the mothers to lie in. And she seems to have found herself the most uncomfortable looking position. Yes, girl, I'm talking about the way that you're lying. Now, you can't really, I don't think you can really gauge it from through the camera, but that wall is probably about 60 degrees, that angle. I mean, I've walked along there, it's really uncomfortable. And she's dangling her head right down over the edge, proving that hyena, just like leopard, can make any position look relatively comfortable, no matter how uncomfortable we would find it if we were in their place. We're just going to sit here nice and quietly and wait to see if the cubs come out. We've spoken about the curious nature of Gwen's lineage, something that I didn't know about, and the fact that she is still, however, a lower ranking hyena than the other three that we've watched over the last few months at the den. We have a question about whether or not a hyena can actually rise several ranks up or down. And the answer is absolutely yes, they can. And in fact, there's sometimes, apparently, there are what's known as coups in a hyena clan, where one line of females actually rise up and take over dominance and push the sort of the higher ranking females down to a lower rank. It's more complex than that, Donna, and I know I haven't fully explained exactly how it works, and that's because I don't think we know exactly how it works. I spoke about the fact that the different animals have different characters, some have more dominance behavior than others, and that might play a role as well, because you might get a sub-ranking female, so a low-ranking female that's born with plenty of testosterone, grows up to be exceptionally large, although the cub's survival rate of lower-ranking females is lower than that of the matriarch, and they actually don't have as much access to food in the same way the matriarch or the higher-ranking females do. But that being said, there's always the possibility. Oh, such a happy stretch. There's always the possibility of a character being born in that's actually capable of fighting for her place in a clan. Now, I think at this stage, the fact that we've come here and the den is still so incredibly quiet apart from Gwen suggests to me that the rest of the hyena clan have moved off. So, another big yawn showing us those yellowed teeth of hers. Might be getting up to call her cubs. Let's just watch. Whoopsie, she nearly fell into the den. I'm going to be quiet so you can hear this. Interesting. She's not calling. Or if she is, it's too soft for me to hear. Come on, little cubs. Waiting with bated breath. I don't want to speak too much in case we can hear her calling. I can't yet. Here we go. Yes. Come on. Come on, little ones. Out she come. Not sure if you guys saw the brief glimpse of the little cub. She's licking it now. There's an ear. Come on, little ones. It's okay. It's okay. Mama's giving them a very thorough bath. This will be my second glimpse of her new cubs. Huh. Big shake. Here we go, there we go. Hello, little one. Yes, we saw you. It's okay. It's okay. Come on. Ah. Okay, let's wait and see if they come around the back for a drink. Hey, girl. You're beautiful, but we did actually come to see your cubs as well, and you put yourself... Oh, there we go, there we go. Hello. Oh, my word. So much. Just hear them squealing. Hello. Ah, oh, I knew that there were two, but this is the first time I've seen them both together. Showing the usual level of coordination. If you're not careful, little one, you're going to fall off mom completely and back into the den. competing over access to nipples. She does have two, and they will each find their place, but what often happens is the first cub to arrive just takes the top one, and the second cub has to try and sort of nuzzle in underneath to get to the one further away. And this one's not having much success. Needle point little teeth we saw there with the yawn. Oh, this is awesome. Mom, I can't get in here, so I'm just gonna stand on you. Starting to squeal, to beg. Definitely the smaller of the two, I would say. Just trying to gauge. I'm seeing both of them out, which probably means we're looking at the male, but not necessarily. Might just be the slightly weaker of the two. Oh, shame, it's so frustrated. Yes, come on. There's two of you. How awesome is this? Oof. I feel for her with those sharp little cub teeth. Cannot be comfortable. And they're not exactly gentle on her. It's gonna fall off any second now. It really doesn't look like the most stable suckling position. Ooh, that's interesting. That the one closest to us is definitely larger. And you can already see the competition that there is between hyena siblings. The little one, probably a little male. Oh, look at that little foot. I'll have to wait his turn. Ah, maybe that's a better angle. And she just looks the picture of contentment. Ooh. I think this might be the most we've seen them fight over access to milk at this age. It certainly is for me, in terms of watching the hyena clan at Juma. I wonder if we don't have two same-sex individuals. The competition within hyena cubs tends to be at its fiercest when they are either both females or both males. And that's because in a male-female divide, the male automatically takes a subservient role. And that was a very conclusive victory that we just saw there. There's a good chance we've got, I don't know, this is all conjecture at this point, but there's a chance we've got two females. It's all right, little one, come on. Back you come. While these two battle it out, apparently James has got an extraordinary view on cheetah plains.
Everyone, how cool is this? Look at that. Buffalo and ostrich in one shot. The buffalo deeply confused by these enormous birds. They have experience only of oxpeckers. They can't believe that there are birds this big. They're terrified that they're about to come and try and peck the ticks from them. That, of course, is absolute nonsense, but it is a wonderful, wonderful sight here. Now, I'm telling you, those three are juveniles, and every time they get close enough, one of the big females starts to demonstrate, and they get a little bit scared, and they move away. There, that one. Every time that one gets, looks like she might, she seems to be wanting to try and sort of have at the youngsters. Isn't this a fun sighting? Buffalo can't believe it. I think the buffalo are also slightly scandalized by our presence here. They don't really know what we are doing either. Didn't find anything that was chasing them. Sean, who spotted the Temminck's coursers, gone round the other side. And now the buffalo are starting to move. David, do you want the sun now? Or you? Yes. David has been giving me nonce uphill about my vehicle positioning all day. There you are. Now you film the sun like I told you to earlier. He said the sun was too bright. Well, of course it was. It's the sun. Wonderful sight. Very nice, David. Kirsten thinks that's wonderful. Wait till you see my photograph. It really is quite spectacular. Gee whiz. This place has delivered to us the last few afternoons, I must say. Yeah, I think those are three juveniles and they're probably being tossed out of the little wobble. In case you're wondering why I'm saying wobble the whole time, apparently that is what a group of ostriches is called. I think it's absolute nonsense. I just called it a flock, but it's quite fun to say the word wobble. And apparently a pride as well. Well, I don't know. I'm not a huge fan of these collective nouns, especially as they're largely not biological terms. Let's go and have another look at these beefies. And while we look at the beefies, apparently they're not nearly as entertaining as the wonderful hyena cubs you're having a look at.
Definitely, this is a good way to end off a day that's almost looked as though it was going to start out on a bad note and then didn't. An incredibly happy moment. Both of them have managed to get access, but just listen to the sounds they're making. The softest of squeaks. Little contented groaning sounds every now and again, but mostly niggling at each other. Plonked back down. Whoops! I'm back, I'm fine. Didn't hurt at all, I swear. There's a very, very clear display of dominance from this little one, with the bald patch on her back. Just watch how this plays out. It's really fascinating. Definitely a lot of competition, more than we saw with the December twins at least, and I think also with the January twins of Madams. At this age, they are absolutely adorable. They look totally different to the adults. A lot of people have compared them to little bear cubs, which I can totally understand. I can definitely see what you mean there. But they will start getting their spots, and Laurie, you were wondering when they get their spots. The answer is in around the sort of second or third month that we start to see the spots coming through. So these cubs are probably older than we think they are. When did we found that den just before the Father's Day specials, so around the 10th of June. when we had the first, or not quite, but maybe that was around where we had the first viewing of them. They were probably a couple of weeks old at that point, although there was that's a matter for some debate. Brent felt as though they were about 10 days old or so. Either way, these cubs are at least a month and a half. So by the time they're about 2.5 months old, you'll start to see the spots coming through. Interesting thing about hyena cub skirmishes, as we're seeing now, is that mom doesn't intervene in any way. It's up to her babies to sort themselves out. And they're doing so very noisily. This is awesome. This must be one of the best sightings we've had of these little cubs so far. And the wonderful thing about it is that it just gets better from here, because they get more and more secure, and they get braver and braver and more curious, and they start to investigate the surroundings of their den. And that to me is one of the most incredible times to get to know a little hyena cub. Since for now our cubs have relaxed, let's go back to James and his incredible view.
Well, we do have an incredible view, everybody, but the beefies have just gone all the way past us. Here they are. They've created a line. I think they're going off towards sort of Mala Mala and the Kruger Park. But there they are. The wind has just come up a little bit as the sun's gone down, and it's coming, like I say, from the east, which is a very unusual wind for us to be having. So tomorrow's weather is going to be fascinating to behold. I'm so glad you've had some time with those cubs. Really good stuff to have more hyena cubs. And I hope she doesn't take them off to the central den, wherever that may be, probably on Simbambili. I hope she doesn't take them off too soon. I think that's just wonderful, don't you? Very cool. And while you were gone, I was taking a picture or two of them, but I was doing it from an unusual angle, wasn't I, David? Yes, I was. I was doing it from underneath the car. And I've taken a rank average photograph, which I will show you. But just understand, everybody, that in showing you, I am exposing it to David, of course, and David is going to take it to pieces. There it is. I was lying underneath the car when I took that. It was such fun. And the buffalo didn't even notice. The angle is, I suppose, quite interesting. And that's all we're going to say about that. David will tell me privately how awful it is. Okay, let's move on from here and see what we can find. The ostriches have gone to Mala Mala for the night. We're going to go back up towards those clearings up in the north there. The beefies are heading into the woodland of the safety of the Kruger National Park. Well, I don't know why it's no safer than it is here for them. Do wonder what chased them out of the bushes there. I see some elephants herring across the plains there. I'll just stop so you can see them. I think they're probably going to have some water at the dam. Can you see them, Dave? There they go. Isn't that a nice sight? That's the kind of sight, everybody, where you take a deep breath in. You smell the osimum or the wild aniseed in your nostrils. You take in the breeze coming from the east, slightly, I suppose it must be said, tainted with the sea, to be honest, but very, very, very slightly. And then you watch elephants walking to have their evening drink. And suddenly you feel all is right with the world. And as it is right with the world here, so it is at the hyena den on Galago Shortcut.
In fact, it probably doesn't get better than this. In watching two relatively new arrivals to the hyena clan find their place in the world. And since little one couldn't really get access to milk, it decided that chewing on mom's toe was the best way forward, or now chewing on mom's leg. Very curious little things, hyena cubs, and most of that exploration is done with teeth. Oh, I'm gonna nibble on mom's leg now. Because I can, and also because I'm teething, and that helps. But mostly just because I want to bite things. I didn't even pick her leg up there for a moment. It's incredible how tolerant these hyena mothers are. She's trying to move them away, whilst not dislodging the cub that's suckling at the same time. Our hyenas, by the way, always come up, the hyena cubs always come up with these little bald spots that you can see on the back of this one's neck and around the back. Now, it might be some manifestation of a minor skin disease or a fungal infection, because they are pretty sedentary initially. And in a den-type environment, you can imagine that breeds are low. Breeds problems. But it could also be scars from where they've been fighting each other. Those teeth are ready to go from very early on. Now for us as human beings to watch a sort of a sibling unfairness is very difficult to witness. And as for those of you who are mothers with siblings, or you have siblings yourself, you know that sort of mothers usually intervene. Renee would like to know why she doesn't. And the answer is because, of course, they don't think like us. And she can't be here the whole time, so there's not really any point to her trying to sort out their sibling rivalry when they'll just do it as soon as she's left. It's part of the natural order of things, and she knows instinctively that it will strengthen them. It's almost a sort of a kill or cure solution. The one will get stronger, or the one will get weaker and possibly not even survive, but it's not really up to her to try and make things fair. Now, hyenas don't really have a concept of fairness. They only know hierarchy and dominance. So she's not going to intervene in any way. She'll let them sort out their battles themselves. Come on, little ones, one last glimpse before we run out of light. Another jolly good clean after a feed. Now, what's interesting about this is the same thing that Ellen Fowler has picked up, and welcome, Ellen, as always. You're interested in the fact that she has this place all to herself, and could it be the possible relationship to Madam? Ellen, it's a really good point. It's one I've been pondering myself. I'm trying to decide if she decided to do this. In other words, when the rest of the clan moved off, did she decide to choose a different den site to them? Or is there another reason behind it? I don't think it's a rank thing. I don't think she pulled rank and sort of got rid of the other hyenas, although her relationship to Madam is really fascinating. I think it's more that she's actually deliberately moved away from the rest of the clan to this den site. And I think she's done that because she's a low-ranking female, and also because of the age difference between her babies and, for example, the January twins, right up until December and November, which would be, you know how there's all kinds of rough housing, the way that hyena plays, or the ways that hyena plays. No, start that whole sentence again. Get those words out. My brain's still on holiday. Hyena cubs play very roughly with each other. There we go. And there's always the possibility of her cub being injured by another one. And I've seen it happen. And the difficulty is because she's low ranking, she can't intervene. So I've seen situations before where the cubs of a higher ranking female have dragged younger cubs around by their ears, with the younger cubs squealing, and the poor anxious mom attempting to protect them, only to be put in her place by the higher ranking mother. So I think she knows that, and I think she's trying to keep them out of harm's way as much as possible. Hello? Oh, you've got such naughty faces at this age. Could you get a better picture of a familial scene? This is so wonderful. In a few short moments, we are going to have to be saying goodbye to our little hyena cubs. Oh, just as I say that, one of them decides to pop out and start exploring. Hello, there's a very big world. Oopsie. Okay, that all got a little bit too much for that very bold hyena cub. To nearly be knocked off the side of the den by mom's head is just too much. And perhaps it's time to seek the relative sanctuary of the den itself. Now for new viewers, the reason I say that we're going to have to be saying goodnight to the hyena cubs is that, as with any of the other cub, or any of the other baby animals actually, regardless of species, we do not shine a spotlight or a light on them. We just don't want to add an extra level of distraction, especially at this small age where their instincts aren't as sharp as the adults and their senses not quite as honed in terms of potential threats. So we don't want to add an additional threat to them, albeit indirectly through shining lights on them. So I think at this point, actually, I think they've gone to bed again. So they've timed that beautifully. I think at this point it's time for us to say goodnight. But never fear, I think she's going to stay here for a while, provided the rest of the clan doesn't come back. So I think we have many exciting months to look forward to with these two little bundles of joy. So while we make our way out of the den site, let's go back over to James, find out what his plans for the rest of the evening are.
I'm not sure I want to share my plans for the rest of the evening with you all, or you might be scandalized. For the rest of the drive, however, I will be here. Well, we're going to spend another 10 minutes or so on cheetah plains before we head back towards Juma. There are some wildebeests, and they are grazing pleasantly across the open areas of Nkoro. I always like the name Nkoro because it means hornbill, you know, and everybody names their lodges after the Big Five: Nyati Lodge, Cheetah Plains, Lion Sands. These guys have named their lodge after the humble hornbill. I think that's very good. David, would you call your lodge Blue Waxbill Lodge, for example?
I think I would.
I think I definitely would. Or Green-Winged Pytilia Camp. Or Muntengu Camp. There we go. That's a much better one. Muntengu Camp, that would be Forked-Tailed Drongo Camp. And like so many of the Shungan words for birds, Nkoro is a onomatopoeic word. Onomatopoeic. Say that, David.
Onomatopoeic.
And that's because a hornbill goes Nkoro, 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 Nkoro. David, stop laughing. You're making the vehicle shake. People are going to get seasick. And just to give you an idea, that picture that you're looking at, and I know I say this a lot, but is much brighter than what the one we're looking at with our naked eye. We are boosting the light signal slightly, and that's so that we don't have to shine a light on those wildebeest. I think they'll probably spend most of the evening out here.
There's a little bit of grass left, and these are sodic clearings, so there's quite a lot of sodium in the soil. That makes the grasses quite nutritious. In fact, the soil is quite toxic to many plants, but of course once it's been filtered through their root systems and their leaves, very nutritious for the grazers that want to come through here and eat them. Hello, Roger in Tampa. Another astute question from you. You want to know the wildebeest in the Kruger National Park migrate. Roger, they don't, and they used to. And the reason they don't anymore is very simply because of artificial water provision. So in the Sabi Sands, they never have to move far for water. What they used to do, however, was go down to the perennial rivers of the Sabi Sand during the winter time, and they would drink there and graze around there. And then during the summer, they'd head up north, apparently, in their thousands, up towards the Timbavati. And the Timbavati River, which used to flow just during a few, you know, for a little while during the summer, and it would have pans along the banks, and that's what they used to do. But now, of course, with tourism, they've put dams all over the place and water holes everywhere, and that means that animals don't migrate anymore. And I think there used to be a huge number of even elephant migrations, Roger, and that was before the advent of villages on the western boundary of the Kruger Park. The elephants used to go off towards the mountains to spend much of the winter, and I think you'll find that before there were too many people in here, which was not too long ago, probably about 200 years ago, you'd find that there were large migrations of animals east-west to the mountains, up into the high veld, which is the highlands for the winter time, and then back down here for the summer when the rains came. That's a lovely picture. It's a very subtly coloured picture, David. Don't you think? Light, gentle greens. Tinge of gold or flax on the grass, brown black wildebeest. Very pleasant. I must say it's got one of those feelings about it this evening. Very pleasant indeed, and it might have something to do with that slightly eerie easterly wind. Right, you say you're interested in those trees there on the eastern horizon. On the horizon that we can see, the tallest ones. Right, he said there are a few. Most of them are knobthorns. There's a marula there on the left-hand side of your screen. Far left is a knobthorn, and then that sort of scraggly one in the middle, I think, is a marula. I'm just going to look with my binoculars. Yeah, it's a marula, that big one. It's still got leaves on it. So largely the knobthorns. That have all lost their leaves and much of their bark, of course, because of the elephants. Very pleasant little sighting. All right, David, I think we should press on from here, see if we can't find a leopard on our way out of Cheetah Plains. Hope you enjoyed those cubs. I must say I'm quite jealous. Only quite jealous, because one mustn't be jealous when one has had the incredible luck we did with Karula yesterday and the day before that. We'll just take the spotlight out and see what we can spot. There were leopard tracks apparently around here somewhere this morning, but there's certainly nothing worth tracking at the moment. We might just be lucky and bump into something. I'm trying to decide on a route. I know what we'll do. We'll go back past Three in a Row Pan and just see if something else hasn't popped out of the woodland to have a drink there before we make our way out. Another lovely question from Howard the Duck. Hello, Howard the Duck. You say, do I think that it's likely that we'll find new animals in this area? Howard, in terms of, you don't mind if I call you Howard, do you? As opposed to Mr. Duck. Sir Duck. Howard, I think the chances of finding new mammals here are almost none. It's possible that a new, say, rodent or bat species could be discovered here. But in terms of mammals, no, I don't think so. At least large mammals, definitely not. But in terms of invertebrates, now remember that's also animals. Invertebrates being insects and arachnids and mollusks and crustaceans and all those sorts of things. Well, then yes, I think it would be possible that there are plenty of species out here that have not been discovered yet or not been described. Many of which have probably been described by local people, but that science has yet to find and discover. And indeed, many of those will go extinct before they're ever described, which in some senses is quite nice, as long as the extinction isn't caused by human beings. It's quite nice to think of things coming into being almost and then disappearing from the earth without us ever having known about it. I think there's something quite nice about that. But how I'd know, birds and mammals, probably not that we'll find another one out here that we haven't seen yet. They do find mammals, sort of one every few years around the world that no one's ever described before. Normally it's something that you wouldn't really want to cuddle, like a sort of subterranean mole rat with enormous teeth, an extremely wrinkly body, or the odd bird. They do sometimes find birds every so often, especially in the rainforests. And if you were to go up to the Congo Basin, for example, the Central African rainforests, where there are so few people and so few researchers have managed to get in there because the people there tend to like to kill each other all the time, you find that you probably could find the odd species that hasn't been described yet. So we'll just pop around the corner to Three in a Row Pans, and I'll keep you updated if we find anything there. But in the meantime, let's go and find out what Jamie's plans for the evening are.
I'm not entirely sure I feel like sharing my plans for the evening. But I'll tell you as long as you all promise not to tell James. They're actually not anything top secret. We're going to be driving along Impala Road. I'm sort of hoping vaguely that we might catch a glimpse of the baby buffalo as it starts to get dark. I'm still dying to see it now up and about and actually on its feet, because of course we never really, whoopsie daisies, got to see the end of that story. There's a giraffe there. Hello. Sorry, girl. You gave me a bit of a surprise there. Completely hidden behind a gwarry bush. I think this might actually be the two females that we saw many, many weeks ago playing with each other and racing across the open clearings. And there's something just so spectacularly picturesque about a giraffe at sunset. As she nibbles away on the buffalo thorn. And the longer you look at them, the stranger they become. So for those of you for whom this is your first giraffe on our live safaris, if you have a look at the top of the horns on her head, it's what tells us that this is a female, because she's got hair there. Hello, girl. Sorry, that was not Brian, that was me. I forgot to take my foot off the brake. Look at the incredibly long eyelashes, and she's also giving us the odd view of that incredibly dexterous and nimble tongue as she plucks away delicately at the buffalo thorn leaves. Definitely wouldn't be my choice of dinner. But for a giraffe, those thorns, however sharp they may be, pose absolutely no threat whatsoever. But yes, we were talking about her horns, the ossicones, as they're officially termed. They're not horns. They don't grow like antelope horns. But the ossicones in males are much, much thicker and rubbed bald from repeated fighting with each other. So that's one of the easiest ways to tell the difference between a male and a female giraffe. She's absolutely going to town on this buffalo thorn. Doesn't that make for an extraordinary picture? I was telling you a bit about the sighting that we had 3 weeks ago, a couple more weeks ago. I watched the young male that was with these females chase them around the clearing, and then they started chasing each other, and then they all went and sort of crowded around one spot where they were going right down as only giraffe can, with by spreading their front legs wide apart and bending right down to sniff whatever was on the ground. And I checked afterwards, I couldn't find a single thing there, and it remains a mystery to this day what put them in such a jolly mood. They were playing with each other. There was no aggression. It was just playful. Really does make for a stunning silhouette, and Brian doing a marvelous job dealing with next to no light. In the distance, I can just hear elephants trumpeting everywhere. They've had a very upset day, the elephants of Juma and the surrounding areas. They've been very, very vocal. And it can't even be to do with the wind at the moment, because the wind has almost completely died down. I actually hear her munching away. Beautiful silhouette. And I agree with Roger in Florida. He says, what a great way to end off an evening, and with some giraffe. Well, Roger, the night is not yet over, but I agree with you. Giraffe in the sunset is, for me, the best way to look at giraffe. Unfortunately, our time spent looking at the giraffe is relatively limited, because we're sort of serving as something of a roadblock for the poor vehicle that is trying to come through. We just better pull off the side of the road for them quickly. All my lights off, yes. So our vehicle lights, unlike most safari vehicles have the spotlights and you've got your brights and your dims. Our vehicles light up like veritable Christmas trees, if not more so. And we've had more than one occasion where we've forgotten just how bright our lights truly are and ended up blinding the poor people who are trying to come past. Isn't that an extraordinary view? What is that? If that's a bat, it's an exceptionally large one. Well spotted, Brian. Incredible camera work going on. Ah, it's not a bat, it is a bird. Thank you, Jim. I think it was Jim. I couldn't actually see in the dark. And there we go. Beautiful silhouette of the giraffe. A male in this case. Now Wayne in Missouri, while we watch them feeding in the sunset in the dusky light, you were wondering if herbivores feed at night. Yes, absolutely they do. Particularly bright full moon nights. They'll alternate between dozing and nibbling away. They don't really have a set bedtime in the same way human beings do, or at least most human beings do. They'll feed throughout the night, and giraffe ultimately will only nap for very, very brief periods of time. They might lie down, particularly on dark nights when they don't really want to run the risk of moving about. They might lie down and settle there and ruminate for a while. But they will feed throughout the night, and all of the herbivores will. They prefer it to do it during full moon nights when there's lots of ambient light around, and usually when it's quite still. It's all a matter of balancing the need for food over the need for survival. Of course, the night is the time of the big cat predators, the lions and the leopards, as well as the hyena. So it must be a little bit scary when darkness falls out here. Not for this giraffe, though. He is perfectly content and looking quite magnificent with his sort of cherry pink background. And of course, if you factor in a dead tree, you've got a stunning image. Hold on one moment. There was one alarm calling Impala, but I think it was a false alarm. Just taking a moment to absorb the scene. Okay, well, the night is drawing on. It's time for us to look for other things to show you before the end of the sunset safari. Let's not delay too much longer. Let's head off. Oops. I think I nearly unplugged myself there. Let's try and pop back onto the road. Hello, boy. I'm just going to keep my lights off for now as we go past. And Eric, while we've been enjoying the scene, oh look, he's got a wonky ossicone. Didn't notice that before. Look at that. Apparently he is familiar to you guys. I'm not sure if that injury is fresh or if it is old. It does often happen with males. We mentioned before about them using their horns as weapons to fight each other. And I would say almost inevitably that's how he broke that ossicone off. And because it is solid bone, that's going to be a permanent disfiguration. That will always be that way. He looks like a hand puppet. I don't know why that thought just struck me. But that's exactly what he looked like.
You've ruined giraffe silhouettes.
I know, I have. I'm so sorry. I don't know why. That just, the way he was moving, it was perfect. Sorry, everybody. I hope I haven't ruined giraffe silhouettes for everybody out there. Because I might have ruined it for myself. Oh no, he really does. I can't unsee it. I can't not see it anymore. Oh, how utterly ridiculous. It's the first time I've ever noticed that. Oh, that's hilarious. Okay. My apologies for that image. You will never be able to scrape that from your mind. A very good hand puppet, I must say. Very good one. Very realistic. That is actually how we do Safari Live. There are no animals here. It is just puppetry. Masterful puppetry. I'm joking, by the way, just for those of you who are new viewers and are very confused by this concept. This is real, real live safari, live in the middle of Africa. It's just every now and again our brains are grasped by a sense of the absurd. There's more Impala alarm calling now. Let's just have one brief look at where they're looking. What's up, guys? Still not frantic enough to be a leopard or a lion close by. Getting there, though. I'm going to go and investigate what's got them so upset. So I shall leave my hand puppet giraffe to his dinner and carry on. While I do, let's find out how James's return journey from Cheetah Plains is panning out.
Well, we're just driving into the most stunning sky at the moment. Hundreds of different colours. And it's just a very lovely warm evening. I mean, this for the middle of winter, this is really astonishingly warm. I've still got my sun hat on as opposed to my woolly cap. And only one jersey. I haven't even got my blankie on my legs. Dave, are you quite warm?
I am.
Good. We saw some elephants on the way out of Cheetah Plains, everybody. They blocked the road for a little while. Then they moved off after pushing over a tree, which was very nasty of them. And now we're heading back. And we are, every time we go through this little drainage line here, which may or may not lose signal, if we go quickly, it probably won't. But we keep going past here, looking at the termite mound on which there grows a very vast tambuti tree, mainly because in it we have seen Tundi 3 or 4 times, and she was very pregnant. We think maybe she's got a little den site around there. So we do look quite carefully as we go through here. Now, there are 2 great valleys in this area, of course, the great valley of the Mulwati drainage, which we know very well from Juma, and this one, the great valley of the Mulwanini, an equally impressively raging torrent. Both of them, I think, tributaries of the Sand River. They've probably become one, in fact, before they hit the Sand River. Now, I'm going to drive a little bit faster, because I think that will probably help us get through here without breaking up the signal. Kirsten will keep us posted as to whether the signal is leaving. So a bit of an experiment to see if we go quickly through, whether that doesn't help. So far so good. You're still with us. And all around us I can hear... What did she say?
Oopsie daisy, and it seems as though on his return to Cheetah Plains, or from Cheetah Plains, James has lost his signal very briefly. Oh, we're continuing on into the night now that our silhouettes are over and most of the background light has disappeared. And we're going off in search of some of the more secretive and nocturnal creatures. Just by the way, I followed up with those alarm calling impala. I think a combination of highly strung nerves amongst the adult males just come to the end of their breeding season, combined with another herd of impala making their way towards them, resulted in something of a little bit of confusion, and that's why they were alarm calling at each other. Nothing like a leopard or a lion wandering straight through, but of course there's still the mystery of where Tingana went to be solved. Now that was my initial thought. And off we go, using the spotlight to illuminate any reflective eyes that might be staring back at us. I'm still trying to crack the Juma nighttime drive. I'm trying to work out where the best place is to go searching for some of our more mysterious animals. Now, I've been trying to do that based on tracks and to figure out exactly where they've been walking or what they've been up to. It's a bit more tricky than it sounds though, because you get their tracks absolutely everywhere. I often wonder about zoes at this time of evening, just because I know from very practical experience, having fallen into one, that there are lots and lots of aardvark burrows there. I'm kind of hoping or working on the assumption that at some point, if I do that often enough, At some point, I will successfully see an aardvark. Just by the way, in case you were wanting to be feeling a little bit jealous, Brent tells me that this morning, while he was staying at his parents' house, he went on a drive and then went for a walk and promptly encountered a leopard on foot, and then shortly afterwards the wild dog pack on foot. He's been having a marvelous time off in a reserve not too far away from Hoedspruit, where the introduced pack of wild dogs, because if you'll remember, the poor wild dog pack in that area contracted rabies, and actually the entire pack was wiped out, and the new pack has been introduced and is absolutely thriving. The female is heavily pregnant. Brent said she didn't so much sprint past him as sort of swish past him or slosh past him. So she's going to be denning any moment now and hopefully replenishing the population of wild dogs that had disappeared. On that happy note, we come now to the end of our portion of the Sunset Safari. Thank you, Brian, for all of your fantastic camera work. And naturally, as the thumb reminds us, a very happy Canada Day to all of you in that part of the world. Thank you to our lovely ladies in Final Control. And most importantly, thank you to all of you watching across the world, sending us through the info, the questions, and just generally enjoying each other's company. Have a fantastic day. We'll catch you tomorrow. Bye-bye, everyone.
We have just turned back onto Juma, everybody. And, yes, not much has happened since we last saw you, except we did go through the two great valleys, where David and I behaved like small children, and we made loud whooping sounds as we went down and up the other side. Didn't we, David?
Yes.
It was great fun. Quite glad there wasn't an animal in the bottom of the drainage line. There is a diker, but unfortunately we cannot look at the diker at night. Margaret, I will do my level best to find your bush bear. I did see one cheetah plains, then I couldn't find it again. I just saw its eyes flashing in the bushes, but then it disappeared. Maybe we'll be lucky. We've had excellent bush baby sightings of late. Yes, James Dungan, were I a very wealthy landowner, it would be wonderful to have a safari lodge called Hendry's Haven. I think my father would thoroughly improve, and I think he would approve, not improve, and I think he'd spend most of his life there, actually. I think that's a great idea, James Dungan. Any idea where I can get hold of such a place? I still think that Nkoro is a rather good name for a lodge. David thinks it's utterly hilarious. He is unable to contain himself. This is round about where we were looking for Karuda earlier on. I don't think she's going to pop out here. I think she's got a kill somewhere to the west of Treehouse Dam. So we'll pop down there in the morning and see if she doesn't pitch up. Another great valley we're going through here. The valley of the Treehouse Dam drainage line. Hold on, David. It's hot down here in the valleys and cold up in the mountaintops where we dwell. It's actually quite the opposite. The katabatic flow out here has rendered the air in the drainage lines very cold, compared with the air in the rest of the place. Like I say, it is the most pleasant evening. I can't believe how warm it is. I suspect it's a harbinger of some frightful weather to come. Margaret, we've only got a minute left and I'm afraid I cannot find a bush baby, but I'm still trying, I promise. Can you see a bush baby anywhere, David? No bush babies, Margaret. Sorry about that. There's a moth, though. Right, that's going to be it from us, Margaret, and everybody else. Thank you very much for watching us today. A big thanks to Kirsten Max Smith in the Final Control with, I think, Chelsea Byrne was helping her out today. Thanks for both of you. And a big thanks to all of you for your questions and comments. It's so nice to chat to you, especially on these drives. We don't necessarily have leopard cubs, but we have lots of interesting little things. Thank you, David, whoever's today. And a big thank you to Jamie Patterson back in the saddle, being filmed, I think, by Brian. We'll see you tomorrow at 06:30.